All right, let's take a look now at an actual example for the ANOVA procedure. Here's some data. Go ahead and pause the presentation, enter that data, and if you want to follow mine keystroke by keystroke, here's L1, here's what I put in L2, and this is what I use for L3. Okay, this data is about three different types of feed, and it was tested on rats over a 30-day period. The data recorded is the weight gain for each of the 30 rats in the study. Does the data suggest that the difference in weight gain between the three diets? So this 118, actually the units are here, but I'm thinking this is not pounds, it's probably grams. This particular rat gained 118, I'm assuming grams or some type of reasonable units for a rat. The 120 would be this rat and this diet gained that many grams of weight or what have you. Okay, the null hypothesis. The null hypothesis would be a statement that they're all the same, that there's no difference between the three. So to do that, I would say that the mean from, say, the first diet is going to be equal to the mean of the second diet, which is equal to the mean of the third diet. That's a statement that there's no difference between the three diets. The alternative hypothesis will simply be, in English, at least one is not equal. Somebody's different. That's the alternative hypothesis. Remember I said earlier that the ANOVA won't tell you which group is different, only if there's a group different. If there is a group different and you need to determine which one, you go to multiple comparison tests. Alpha, let's stay with 0.05. And let's go ahead and take a look at the assumptions and see if we can satisfy them and complete the ANOVA. Now, independence. Are these groups independent? Yeah, there's 30 rats. They're broken up into three groups. Each group gets a different diet or different type of food. So, yeah, if one rat in group one gains weight, there's no connection between a rat in group two or group three. So it's reasonably independent. So this is reasonable. Of course, I just talked my way through it. I would expect my students to actually write out why. Just a couple sentences to briefly explain why. You don't need to do a whole dissertation on it. The normality assumption. Well, I have three groups here. I'm going to say this is diet one. This is going to be diet two. This will be diet 3. So if I go ahead and switch to my calculator now, I can take a look at the normal plot for each. First one is not all that wonderful. It's not all that bad, but it's not exactly exciting. So I'm going to scribble this down quickly so I can return to it. And then go ahead and go to the next one. Here's a second normal plot. And again, I'm just going to write down briefly or roughly what I'm looking at. And then, one more time, with the third set of data. Okay, switching back to the computer now. If we look at this, these are rough sketches. You know, in general, I'm thinking, I have some issues here. I don't like this. This bothers me a little bit. I'm thinking these are probably not normal. So at this point, I would switch and go to a non-parametric technique. I just don't feel real comfortable with this. However, for sake of discussion, what I'm going to do here to walk you through the actual mechanics is we're going to proceed right now as if it was normal, and then I'm going to come back and do the non-parametric technique. So I'm thinking these are not normal. They bother me a bit. So correctly, I would say use a non-parametric technique, but we're going to walk through this as if it was normal so you can see how it's done. Okay, now assuming that we did feel okay on the normality assumption, I need to take a look at similar variances. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to list a bunch of information here. Let's see, I'm going to say group 1, group 2, group 3. And the reason I say a bunch of information here, because I know some of this could be useful. I think I'm going to grab the means from each group, the standard deviation from each group. And I may as well, while I'm there, go ahead and get the sample median from each group. So I'm going to grab all three of those from each. Now, in terms of addressing similar variances, it's actually the standard deviations that I'm going to be looking at. So let's go back to the calculator. Go stat, calc, one variable statistics for L1. And this had an average of 100. The standard deviation was 15.1364. Probably should have made these boxes a little bit bigger. Sorry about that. I'm going to go down and get the median, which is 103. Repeat this for L2. The mean was 99.5. Standard deviation is 10.9163. And scoot down here, and the median was 100. And then lastly, I will repeat it for that third data set. The mean was 84.1, standard deviation of 15.4017, and come down here, grab the median, which is 85. Okay, switching back now. I've written that data down and into this grid. Like I said, I probably should pick bigger boxes. It didn't fit real well, but hey, what the heck. Now, the similar variances. What I'm going to do is I'm going to identify the biggest and the smallest standard deviation. The idea here, if I take the smallest and the biggest and do an F-test to see if they're similar, if I fail to reject, that would suggest they're not different, so I'd go ahead as if they were similar. Well, if the biggest and the smallest are similar, then what do you think about the middle one? Well, it must be similar, too. It kind of squeezes it in there, right? So, I'm going to set up my null hypothesis. I'm going to say, let's see, H-naught, sigma squared. Okay, where's the smallest? The smallest one is 10.9, right? So, sigma squared group 2 divided by sigma squared. All right, where's the biggest? That's 15.4. So group 3 equals 1. The alternative hypothesis is sigma squared for group 2. Sigma squared group 3 is not equal to 1. All I'm interested in is similar or not. I don't really care which one's bigger if they're different. It's just, are they similar or not? So I'm using the alternative hypothesis of not equal to. Well, what's the assumptions for the F-test? Normality and independence, right? Well, we've already done that. So if we jump back to the calculator, I'll go to stat, test, two-sample F-test. I have data, and I will compare group 2 and group 3, L2 and L3, and the alternative hypothesis, all I'm interested in is not equal, so I'll select it. I will calculate it. And p-value, 0.3197. So coming back to my computer, I'm going to write down p-value goes 0.3197. Therefore, I may as well write therefore. Therefore, fail to reject, which implies they're similar. If I rejected, then they would not be similar, and I have to do something different. Now, something different will depend on the way your professor is approaching your particular course. The something different could very easily be simply switching to the non-parametric technique, or your book talks about variance stabilizing transformations. Some professors have you work with that, some don't. The variance stabilizing transformations is a method of transforming data that may stabilize the variances so that this assumption can be satisfied. The idea is if you try one of these transformations and it works, then go ahead and do your NOVA on the transformed data, and then you always transform back later if you need to. Or as needed, I should say. So, in this case, there wasn't an issue. We have similar variances, so now I can go ahead and proceed with completing the ANOVA. So, switching back to the calculator, I will go to Stat, Test, and I am going to go up arrow, which brings it to the bottom, and select ANOVA. Now, what do you think it's looking for? The data. So I'm going to do second L1, comma, second 2, comma, and L3. Close it up. So this is saying do an ANOVA with the data in those three lists. Hit Enter. And what I'm looking for is this p-value. And the p-value is 0.0261. There's a bunch of different, or there's a bunch of information down here, which if you will be doing multiple comparisons, again, some professors do it and some don't, this information will be necessary for multiple comparisons. If you're not doing multiple comparisons, then the p-value is really all that you're interested in. So I'm going to switch back to computer and say, all right, my p-value equals 0.0261. So therefore, my decision will be to reject the null hypothesis, which then implies that somebody's different. One of these groups is at least one of these groups is different from the others. It could be that all three are actually different, or it could be that two are clumped together and one of them's different. Well, to determine which is different, then what you really need to do is switch to a multiple comparison test. Now, you may be thinking, wait a minute, didn't you say earlier that one of the reasons we do ANOVA, not a bunch of t-tests, is because the alpha, the probability of type 1 error, balloons on you? So we have a p-value here, but now you're suggesting that we go to these multiple comparisons and look at more p-values, essentially, so won't that balloon on us? And you're probably thinking, well, why don't we skip ANOVA, and if we have the assumption satisfied, skip the ANOVA and just go straight to the multiple comparisons. Well, that's a legitimate thought. And the problem with that, it's been shown through research that if you simply go to the multiple comparisons, the probability that you make a type 1 error somewhere, that you screw up, basically, and I shouldn't say screw up, but you come to a wrong conclusion, actually is ballooned. It's kind of just the opposite we talked about earlier with the multiple t-test. When you go to a multiple comparison, that p-value is actually what's referred to as a protected p-value. It's protected in that if your ANOVA did not give you a p-value small enough to go look for multiple comparisons, then don't do it. It's being protected by that first test, right? That first ANOVA test is protecting you, or protecting the process from going on and doing something you shouldn't be doing in the first place, and then as a matter of simply random chance, finding a difference that doesn't really exist. So if your professor's having you do multiple comparisons, you always do the ANOVA first to protect against a future error, and if the p-value as it is here is small enough that suggests go ahead and do a multiple comparison, see who's different, then do your multiple comparisons. Another approach at this level, of course, may be simply to say, hey, look at the means or the medians, probably the means because we are dealing with ANOVA right now, and see if it's logical who's different. Well, looking at these values, 100, 99.5, 84.1. There's my guess. It looks to me like the first two are probably not going to be statistically different from each other. Probably not. That's what I would suspect if I did the multiple comparisons. But this guy is. It looks like this third diet does not do as well in terms of weight gain as the first two diets do. So again, this is completely dependent on how your professor is approaching your course. Do you need to go on and do a multiple comparison, or does he or she just want you to eyeball it and say, yeah, it looks like this is it, and leave the multiple comparisons to another course, or think of it as a slightly higher or more advanced technique. Okay, so that's it for the ANOVA. In the next section I'm going to go to, I'm going to talk about the non-parametric technique If we have a violation of our assumptions, which I think we really did back when we looked at those normal plots, I think there's just problems in here. And this kind of concerns me too a little bit. What do we do next? Well, non-parametrics.